Now opening for Crosby, Stills, and Nash, the Partridge Family.
I woke up in love this morning.
I think we were the original Milli Vanilli.
Anytime anybody ever said to me, those kids play pretty well, I would want to send them out to be analyzed.
2, 3, 4.
Doesn't somebody want to be wanted like me?
The Partridge Family couldn't possibly take their act on the road.
I can feel your heartbeat. And you didn't even say a word.
People would come to me and say, why don't you guys play Las Vegas? And I kept saying, you don't understand. There is no Partridge Family.
The band was pure fantasy.
It was painful for me in a lot of ways, watching Danny Bonaduce strumming his bass.
David Cassidy finally came to me and goes, hey, man, you don't strum a bass. You pluck it.
I think I love you.
The group was a fake. David Cassidy was the real thing.
David is the engine that made that music work.
Right off the bat, he became the hugest thing since Elvis Presley.
In the eyes of the world.
Then, though the Partridges sold millions and millions of records, teen idol David Cassidy became bored by bubblegum.
He did not like being labeled a teen idol. He wanted a rock.
And we were not a rock family.
Am I losing you? Am I losing you?
After 4 frenzied years in the spotlight, the Partridge Family's superstar singer got off the bus.
He just pretty much said, I don't want to do it anymore.
I remember people saying to me, how could you give that up? How could you walk away from that at the top? It was either that or die.
And when the musical comedy was over, a tragedy was just beginning.
It's one of those nights when you turn out the lights and you sit in the dark and say to yourself,
what did my drug problems lead to? Jail and rehab. Degradation, humiliation, breaking the hearts of people that loved me, jail and rehab.
I literally would put myself under the car and lay there and say, make your choice, drive over me to get drugs or go back in the house.
A whole lot of loving is what we'll be bringing. We'll make you happy.
Now, the tale of television's favorite fabricated musical family, the Partridge Family, behind the music.
Right in the middle of a good dream, like all at once I wake up from something that keeps knocking at my brain.
The Partridge Family's first single in 1970 outsold classic recordings by Simon and Garfunkel and the Beatles.
Screaming out the words I dread, I think I love you.
That year, the National Association of Recording Merchandisers awarded Single of the Year honors not to Let It Be or Bridge Over Troubled Water, but to the Partridge Family's I Think I Love You.
I think I love you, so what am I so afraid of? I'm afraid that I'm not sure of a love there is no cure for.
From 1970 to 1974, the Partridge Family racked up 6 gold albums and 7 top 40 hits.
So it worries me to say that I never felt this way.
But the band was just a gimmick. 11-year-old Brian Forster was a novice on drums. Danny Bonaduce could barely hold his bass guitar. And Susan Day was faking it on keyboards.
I think most people believe that the Partridge Family were, you know, Susan Day playing the tambourine and the keyboards, and David Cassidy, of course, sang, but very few people realize that the musicians on the Partridge Family were top-notch session musicians.
The first time I had to audition, I sat down and I picked up my guitar and I started riffing. And they went, actually, we won't be asking you to play guitar. We have Larry Carlton and Louis Shelton. Oh, okay. And Hal Blaine will be playing drums. And Joe Osborne and Max Bennett will be playing bass. And Larry Nechtel and Mike Melvoin will be playing keyboards. And I went, oh, I guess I won't be playing any instruments in this.
Known for his jazz chops, but in fact, he actually was the keyboard player for the Partridge Family.
I was Susan Day. Can you imagine that? Frequently, I played piano and harpsichord. And Susan Day looked like she was playing this little electric keyboard. And Hal Blaine had the most amazing, huge set of drums that would have dwarfed the little kid completely.
We used to put on our teenage thinking caps when we walked into the studios. When they said bubblegum, we knew exactly where we were going bubblegum-wise.
In 1999, David Cassidy and the men behind the Partridge Family sound reunited to re-record a couple of their classics for an NBC movie based on David's life.
I went in the same booth with the same guys 25 years later and recreated the same moment, and I was so present and I was so thankful. I went, thank you, God. They say you can never go home again. And in my case, I got to go home again.
Hey, I think I love you. So what am I so afraid of? I'm afraid that I'm not sure of. A love there is no cure for.
For David, it was a chance to reconnect with the musicians and the music that helped to launch his career a quarter century ago.
And when I would go out on the weekends and years afterwards, since I've done it hundreds of times, it got a little faster, but it got a lot heavier. Ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom.
I can feel your heartbeat, and you didn't even say a word.
Oh, I know, pretty woman, that your love can be heard. Oh.
First-rate studio singers provided the Partridge Family's backing vocals then and now.
In the Partridge Family, we were the sound except for David.
It was so much fun to go back and actually recreate that again, that it was perhaps the most exciting and satisfying moment I've ever had in the recording studio.
That's cool. You know, you guys can play.
You don't sound like 30,000
people. But now we have to take a nap.
Three decades earlier, the television studio that spawned the Monkees was looking for its next hit series.
Wake up to a male day, one that's sure to move you.
Screen Gems developed a sitcom idea based on a real-life singing family.
Actually, the inspiration came from a Rhode Island-based singing group called the Cowsills, who basically were a bunch of brothers and a sister whose mother was put into the band by their father, who was their manager and who ran the family.
The Cowsills hit the top 40 four times between 1967 and 69, winning fame for their smash rendition of Hair.
That image of Mom driving on a bus to concerts where the kids would perform became the inspiration for the Partridge Family.
We just knew they were proposing a TV show that we could be in.
And they wanted to look at
us.
Hey,
great. Yeah. And it's about a mom and a rock band. Well, that's us. You came in the right house.
Yes, you got the right address.
You know.
Bernie Slade, who wrote the pilot, and I went out there, and we saw them as a family, and the only one that seemed to work was a little girl. She was adorable.
Little sister Susan was the youngest Cowsill, but her teenage brothers were now too old for the series.
We're all growing daily, you know, maturing daily, and they've got this stuff coming out of our mouths. Yeah. Like, it's like, what? Am I going to say that? That's like 5 years old, isn't it?
There's no way it was going to work out.
With the Cowsills ruled out, the producers set out to...